welcome. If it's okay by you, we can continue in English because it's better than my bad Swedish anyway.
Yeah.
My bad English is better than my bad Swedish.
I understand you better, perhaps, in English than in Norwegian. Who knows?
Probably. hopefully. Your research shows that Neanderthals had sex with humans. This is very surprising.
Is it?
To me, anyway, because I thought they were living in different millenniums. Mm. Oh.
Well, they actually overlap. So Neanderthals are our very closest relatives. They are like 10 times closer to us than chimpanzees are. And they lived until about 30 or 40,000 years ago. And they actually met modern humans when they came out of Africa and encountered them then in Europe and Western Asia. And I'm not surprised we had sex with them. I think we have sex with almost everything we encounter in our history. The surprising thing to me was that one actually had babies together, and that those babies obviously were integrated into modern human society and came to contribute to people today genetically.
So how do you imagine these dates? How did they, they were bigger than us, weren't they?
They were stockier, more muscular, yeah.
Yes. So they were having sex with us, not the opposite. Like, probably.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes I tend to say how we think about this, say more about our own fascinations and imagination than what really happens.
I was just asking. What is it? What's happening today? It's like, how much of a Neanderthal are we? Hmm.
Well, it depends on who you are. If your roots are in Europe and Asia completely, it's somewhere between 1 and 2% of your DNA that comes from Neanderthals. If you're from Africa, you have no Neanderthal contribution because there were never any Neanderthals in Africa.
So we would be Neanderthals? Apart.
Apart, say. But
would it differ from person to person?
Well, if, for example, one of your parents is from Africa, you will have about half of the contribution from Neanderthals, right?
Okay, so anyone Maybe. Have parents from Africa here? No?
Probably all of us actually have parents in Africa.
we spring from there.
So we're all like quite much Neanderthals?
Yes.
And how does that... will that... where can we see it? I mean, can I see it on my hands? Can I see it on my legs or face? Or is it like...
We begin to learn a little bit about that now from studies that come from using the Neanderthal genome that we have determined. So it turns out that some genes involved in immune defense, for example, how we deal with bacteria and viruses that attack us, some variants of such genes come from Neanderthals to us. There are variants that cause risk to get type 2 diabetes, the type of diabetes you get at old age, that come from Neanderthals. And there is actually in Tibet, Tibetans who live at high altitude on the Tibetan plateau, a gene variant that allows you to live at such low oxygen tensions there come from a relative of Neanderthals that we also discovered from the Denisovans. Mm. So they have actually, to some extent, have had important influences on people today.
If we lived on Earth at the same time, why did humans win in the end?
That is a good question that no one really has an answer to. It has something to do with how modern humans behaved, of course, because it's not only the Neanderthals that disappeared. Other forms of humans in Asia disappeared. You know, these little hobbits, Homo floresiensis in Indonesia, disappeared. The last 30,000 years of our history is actually unique because it's just one form of humans around in the world today. So it has to do with our behavior in some form. But what that is not at all clear.
And how far back in history can you go?
Well, so these techniques we now developed to sequence the Neanderthal genome, we're now trying to apply them to older things, and we've gone back to 400,000 years ago to a site in Spain we were sort of ancestors of Neanderthals, where we're beginning to get some DNA now. So I would say 500,000 years, perhaps approaching 1,000,000 years or so in the future, one will be able to go.
So you can techniques. you can find DNA that's almost 1,000,000 years old.
Well, so what we have done with human ancestors is 400,000. In the permafrost, yeah, where things have been permanently frozen, one had gone back 700,000 years of animal remains. No dinosaurs.
Tell me, no dinosaurs?
No dinosaurs.
So the Jurassic Park, it's just...
That's out, in my opinion, yes.
That won't happen?
No.
Are you disappointed now?
No. I mean, everybody sort of knew that, I think. It was, Jurassic Park was a book written by Michael Crichton, and it was just something that he more or less came up with. It was a good, interesting theory and very entertaining, but it's pretty old, 65 million years and older.
When you were at the dinner party, what do people ask you?
Well, I think one thing that very often comes up and make me a little tired is this: can we bring them back? Can we clone a Neanderthal?
Because you can't.
You can't, really.
Is it in your book? You write about your father. He was a Nobel laureate, and still you did not grow up in his shadow. That's fair to say, because you didn't see much.
Yes, so my father met my mother when he was a professor in Lund in southern Sweden, and she was a student and technician in his lab. And then I was created, and this was in the 50s. So my mom had to leave town, and I was born in Stockholm then. And after a while, my father actually became a professor here at the Karolinska Institute. So he would show up on Saturdays for a few hours when his family thought he was working in the lab.
So that was a secret. You were a secret child.
Yes, certainly secret. Yes.
How was that for you?
I grew into it. From my very earliest memories, this was how it was. That my father had another family, had another son, very same age as I, and they didn't know about us though. So I met my brother only when my father was dying in 2004.
You had you had an interesting life yourself, you were in a similar situation, one can say, but made a very different choice.
You mean when I met my wife, yeah, Linda? Yes, she was already married. And of course it was a crisis, but we actually managed to overcome that crisis with her then husband also. So we even moved into the same house for a while and lived together.
You and her husband and...
Yes.
And her?
Yes. Now he lives 2 blocks away, actually.
This is like the Swedish movie Tillsammans.
Okay. Maybe. I haven't seen that one. Okay.
Don't do that. Okay. Okay. No, but you were sort of... when you decided to tell him, to confront the situation, had that to do with your father's life?
I think many things in my life probably have to do with that I saw my father's double life and said, I don't want to live like that. So both this case and the fact that I'm attracted both to men and women sexually, for example, things that I have tried to be open and straightforward about. And
yes, you were living with a man before, right?
No, yes.
You've become quite a famous scientist, and your research on the Neanderthals has been world news. Is it? I wonder if the most surprising place they were interested in your research, that was Playboy, wasn't it?
Maybe, but. Since it has
I don't know. I didn't read that piece, I must okay. say. I just yeah. heard about mm-hmm. it because...
Well, since it has to do with sex, I guess they were interested. And I thought, this is my one chance to be in Playboy magazine. So I agreed to. <yeah. laughs>
so, So how was the piece? How did it look?
I think it was surprisingly serious, actually. The pictures that accompanied were not so serious, but the text was pretty serious.
But the pictures of you?
No, it was pictures of Neanderthal women.
And they were not serious? Because they didn't really have the Neanderthal women, I suppose?
Exactly, yes.
How did they depict them?
Rather unattractive, I must say.
Well, to be honest, weren't they quite unattractive? Or? Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Don't you... But we have seen them, right? Or did they look different than we think, the Neanderthals?
I think the only thing we know is that they were quite robust. Let's say the muscle attachments are quite big. They must have been quite muscular. And then it depends if you find that attractive or not.
And very hairy?
Are you into muscle attachments?
Mm-hmm.
Aren't we all? I mean, we're trying in several ways. Am I the only one trying to work out sometimes?
As long as it is not yoga, you are saying. Huh?
Not yoga, but still.
Or meditation.
But is it they would be stronger than us in many senses?
On average, they would be stronger.
So
physically, yes.
If the Neanderthals were living among us today, how would they manage?
They would probably manage pretty well, but there would probably be some differences, probably in the cognitive area of some sort. Because it's after all true, Neanderthals lived for 300,000-400,000 years. And their stone tools at the beginning of their history, at the end of their history, were very similar. We have existed a little over 100,000 years, and I think we all agree that our culture and technology are very different today from 100,000 years ago. Mm-hmm.
So we could make them pay quite a lot for our smartphones?
Mm-hmm. Maybe.
Because they wouldn't really invent something?
Maybe. Or maybe it has something to do with our sociality. The fact that there are many people who speculate that we spend, you know, first third of our life to learn what previous generations have learned. And then we add to that, that we have this enormous drive to sort of communicate and transmit knowledge, especially to our children, and that may be a key. It may not be that they are less smart individually than we are, but we have this enormous sociality. That's very typical.
But we still kill in the same barbaric and primitive way, unfortunately.
Or even more organized
and
large scale.
Organized.
Yes.
Yeah, that's the sad thing.
Are you saying that possibly it's the parenting style? The innate parenting social behavior?
Yes, so people who have that theory, that we have this sort of enormous, at least if we compare ourselves to the great apes, it's sort of striking how the parents do not teach at all. The children of chimpanzees sit for hundreds of hours trying to learn cracking nuts next to their mother, and you see these videos, and as a human you say, sure, kid, show. And they don't, right? Whereas a large part of what we do when we interact with our children is to transmit knowledge, correct their behavior. Mm-hmm. Many societies institutionalize this with schools and universities. We have an enormous emphasis on that's transmitting nice. Knowledge.
Interesting. Mm. That's really interesting.
Svante, thank you so much for being here. What did you have to...
He made me exercise, which really... it's just a terrible, terrible thing. I couldn't believe it. I, who love to sit and talk, was forced to exercise.